Hello, testing, okay.
Yeah, so maybe you need to stand a little closer to the microphones.
Okay.
Let them work for you, right?
One, two.
Testing. All right.
I'm not on.
From the top?
He's not on. Are you on?
Test, one, two, no.
Not on.
At least I don't hear. Test, there we go.
Yeah, okay.
Testing.
Boom.
Test, okay.
One, two.
Yes, please.
I want to thank everyone for coming this morning. We will be starting in about 10 minutes. We're still waiting for a few family members to arrive who've got delayed. And as soon as they arrive, we will begin the service. And I know it's very crowded. Thank you all for making the space. And for those of you who may need it, there is an overflow room just over here, our Friendship Hall, where the service will be live streamed on a large screen. If you need to make use of that. For those of you who have not been here before, our restrooms are also out the back and down the hall to your left. But thank you so much for coming, and we will begin shortly.
everybody.
Thank you for coming and being here. Death is never pleasant. But this death has taken our soul and our emotions to deeper depths than before. Raj was too young, and he was taken too soon. It's hard to understand. But this is where we have to have faith in God. He had a better plan for him. On behalf of Lisa, Luke, Matthew, his devoted parents, James Hina and Christopher Jones Sadhanala, his sister Mary and brother Sammy, and the rest of his extended family, I welcome you all. The fact that you are here and the fact that this church is full attests to the type of person Raju was. He was kind, loving, a heart as big for everybody in this room and more. Thank you all once again. My father, who is the grandfather of Raju and the brother of his father, Christopher Jones, is going to offer prayer.
What do I pray, huh?
Yes.
Let's bow our heads. Our loving Father, God of our fathers, we invite thy holy presence at this special occasion. We have gathered this morning to celebrate the life of Raju Sadhanala, who touched our hearts and our lives with his humility, kindness, and generosity. Bless and comfort Lisa, Luke, Matthew, his parents, Mary, Sammy, and numerous religious relatives and friends. Help us to think of the splendor of life, everlasting, ever with you. Bless this service today and grant us the blessed hope of the resurrection and eternal life and our eternal home. We ask these blessings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, I'll come.
Would you all please stand and join us in singing Nearer, My God, to Thee. If you want to follow in your hymnal, it's number 473. The words will be on the screen for you. Nearer, My God, to Thee.
For those of you who don't know, I am Lisa's dad. This is my grandson. I'm going to be reading from Revelation 21, 1 through 5. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, come down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautiful dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, nor mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are worthy and true." Amen.
Thank you. I will be reading Rajanna's life sketch. Rajkumar Jones Sadhanala was born to Christopher Jones and Jamesina Sadhanala on September 22, 1969 in Madanapalli, India. He grew up in Takoma Park, Maryland, where he attended Sligo Seventh-day Adventist School, Takoma Academy, and Columbia Union College. Raj was known as a bright, charismatic student. He served on the Student Council and made his parents proud as a member of the National Honor Society. Raj loved all sports and played basketball at the TANCUC. Even as a student, he was keenly interested in the community. This led him to the Adventist Community Service Center. It was there that he met his future wife, Lisa Hollinger. Contrary to the common knowledge, Lisa was the first one to make a move. They shared their first kiss on Valentine's Day, even before their first date. Raj proposed to Lisa on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, and in 1997, they were married. Not long after, they moved to Loma Linda, California. Raj would complete his degree as a physical therapy assistant and finished his term as the president of his graduating class. While in California, the young couple had their first son, Luke Jones Sadhanala. The couple later decided to move back to Maryland to be near family. When their second son, Matthew William Sadhanala, was born in 2008, they were already in the Washington, D.C. area. Raj was intensely involved in the lives of his children. He participated in their school and church and social activities. He coached a team in the Spencerville Adventist Baseball League, assisted coaching for Beltsville Ballers, taught Sabbath school, and engaged himself in home and school at Beltsville Seventh-day Adventist School. Early in his career, Raj purchased Access Physical Therapy Practice in White Oak, Maryland. Every aspect of his life was in service to others, and his career path was yet another example of his commitment to them. He touched numerous lives and with his caring and selfless attitude. Apart from being a model son, loving husband, father, he was an extraordinary friend who reached many members of his class, community, and even strangers. He never met a stranger that he didn't know. His generosity of heart and soul knew no bounds. It is evident in the genuine friendship and family relationships that he developed over the years. Raj is survived by his loving wife, Lisa, his two handsome sons, Luke and Matthew, his devoted parents, Jamesina and Christopher Sadhanala, his sister Mary, brother Sammy, and a host of extended family and loyal friends. Thank you.
Good morning. Where do you begin? What do you say on the day that you're burying your brother? Raj was a lot of things to me, my family, all our friends. He was a friend, a brother, an uncle, a rival. He was everything you could put in that list, everything. He meant so much to everyone he met. Even the people he didn't meet that saw how much people were mourning this week and just felt they needed to be a part. That's what he meant. I first met Raj back in 1984 in high school. I was a senior and he was a freshman. But I felt like I knew him much earlier than that because as a young freshman, I discovered my first infatuation for Indian women and his sister Mary. And I can hear him now, hey, hey. And later on in my high school career, you know, we started working at the hospital and we met his mom and developed that relationship. So I heard about Raj and of course Sammy long before any friendships began. But when we finally met in 1984, Raj, of course, to his friends and his contemporaries was the man. And some have said that about myself and how we carry on with my contemporaries and our age group. And so that in itself kind of made us clash because we were two guys that just wanted to call the shots all the time. And like I said, we were rivals, we were friends, we were very similar, but we were very opposite. You know, we even loved the same girl one time way long ago. But that first year I took him under my wing. He was my little brother, you know, and the other guys followed along, Brian, you know, Mike, Andrew, the rest of the guys, and that's how we carried it. He was my little brother throughout his high school career, but we kind of lost touch in college for certain obvious reasons, and we didn't really connect back until we were both out of college. He had met Lisa, I had met my wife, and both went off to got married, started our families, and we really became close after that when he moved back from California. That's when our relationship really started. And we did everything together. We were inseparable. You know, he was always there for me, always there for my family. You know, Raj would give you the shirt off the next guy's back. That's how kind he was. You know, and he was just amazing. He's an amazing guy. He's a brother. I was proud to call him a brother. And later on in life, over the past couple years, the relationship kind of turned, and he kind of became my older brother. And he started taking care of me, and he started worrying about what's going on with you. And the conversation that we had many times about funerals was never about his funeral. It was always about mine. And he was supposed to go after me, and he was supposed to be up here talking about me. So, you can never prepare for things like this. You never understand why, and I haven't even begun to think about what this means and how to translate it and how to process it, but you know, I felt that I needed to come up here and speak and let people know what he meant to me. We were in the hospital Sunday morning, and Sammy and Prem were there. We were there. Everybody had gone back to the hotel. They had fallen asleep in the waiting room, so I said, I'm going to go talk to Raj and hang out with him for a couple hours because I needed to leave at 7 that morning to come back to Maryland for something. So I was sitting there speaking with him, you know, and you could see that he was deteriorating because earlier in that evening he was breathing on his own with some help from the ventilator, but now he was just really using the ventilator. And I was talking to him and I said, the whole premise of that conversation was, Raj, it's okay. You know, Luke, Maddie, the boys will be okay. We got Lisa. You know, all your uncles, all the brothers are here. You got to do what you got to do. If you need to go, go. If you're going to fight, then fight like hell and come back. But don't get stuck. Just do what you got to do. And just then my family came in, and it was just us four there with him. I said, okay, kids, say bye to Uncle Raj. It's time to go. My wife leaned over, kissed him on the forehead. And he started to tear. What does that mean? Who knows what that means? You know, the jury's always still out on what people hear and can't hear and what they process. But I choose to believe at that moment in time, God said, and Raj had a conversation, and Raj, you know, was saying, look, brother, I want to come back, but God needs me more. So I got a new role. I'm not leaving. I'll be gone for a while. And that was that. So Raj was my brother. He will always be my brother. And I will always be grateful to have known him. And I know he's up there. He's got them onions going. He's got that tomato going. He's got the ginger paste going. He's ready to roll, just waiting for us to get there. So that's what I choose to take away from this. It's not a sad day, but it's a joyous day because God called him and needed him more. And that's that. Thank you.
All these guys wanted to say something, but I think if they did, we'd be late to eat. And so I was fortunate enough to do the talking. How are you doing? Raj told me a long time ago when, and you're going to get to meet his nephew and two nieces in a couple seconds, when Supriya, Shailesh, and Shefali were young, Raj told me that his approach to them was to be honest with them. If he said something, if he was gonna get popsicles, or if he was gonna do anything, he did it, or tried very, very hard to. I try to do that with my niece. I don't know if she's here or not, but I try to be very honest with her, and I try to brush her off. And if I say something, I try to do it. He did that with Maddie and Luke also. There were several times that we had to go out to get something because he told Maddie or Luke that he was gonna get him for him. Not exactly sure why we had to go out and get it, but we did. And because he had that honest track record, and because I'm trying to have that honest track record with the kids, I think I can say safely to Maddie and Luke, you're going to be okay. I just want to let you know that. Unless you're in a tub full of Jell-O. I meet people outside that have lost people, and they talk about the hole in their life, the void in their life. And Raj Sadhanala left an asteroid crashing to the Earth crater in all of our lives. And I don't know if one person actually filled those shoes, filled that void. I tried to fill out one of his suits earlier and I couldn't do it. So I think I have a solution. I see all the guys here. These are all of his brothers, uncles to his kids. We have what I like to call Rajisms. Little sayings that he did, little things that he did that we all know about. I'm going to mention three of them. Or is it four? I can't remember. I think it's three. Never fill up your gas tank. If gas is over $2 a gallon, put in $5 worth of gas. If gas is under $2 a gallon, put in $10. He called me one time and he said, hey, I'm out of gas. I'm on Piney Branch Road, and can you bring over some gas? And I'm like, sure, yeah. So I got a can of gas and I went over there and I jump out of the car, and he comes running back to my car, and he's like, thanks, man, I got it. And I was like, well, you know, I'll wait till you put the gas in. He goes, no, you can take off, I got it. And I said, that seems a little rude. But so I started walking towards the car, and I looked in the car, and Lisa was sitting in the car. And I said, hey, Lisa, what's going on? She said, hey, Russ, not much. It's date night. So I got back in the car and I took off and I let him deal with it. That's fine. The second thing, always try to say goodnight to your kids. Tell them a story, tuck them in, spend a little time with them. He encouraged a lot of reading and stuff like that. Not a lot of TV. They never knew what was going on TV, but always say goodnight to them. Spend a little time with your wife. And then call your friends up and go to Walmart. I'm not married. I don't have kids. Is that what you guys do? Because that seems like that was a great night out for us. The third thing has to do with basketball. He had a great saying. Call your own fouls and respect the call. Yeah. Respect the call. And he always, when he got mad at Shilish and Shafu and Shapali, he would always say, listen! So I just want to throw that out there. One more thing. He was the president of WWC. It was a very hard-fought campaign, and he became the president after a long struggle. I am not going to tell you what WWC means. I want you to find out from his friends or his wife, and I want you to have that moment. Because he was very proud of being the president. I think Sammy's going to be the president now, right? Is that right, Sam? You're taking over? Vice president. It was his mission in life to become president, and he worked like a dog to do so. I like that sentence. All right. In conclusion, there's a couple of conclusions. To Luke and Maddie, Luke told me about this last night, and I remember him saying it to me. He would always say to Luke and Maddie, slay the dragons, storm the castle, and rescue the damsel in distress. And now I'm going to finish up by saying Raj could fall asleep anywhere. We're not going to talk about snoring, right? Now we're not going to do that, but he could fall asleep anywhere, at any time. And so finally now, I just want to say to you, rest in peace. We love you, and we'll talk to you later. Thank you.
My Uncle Raj was more than just my uncle. He was another father to me. He took care of us and raised us just like his own. He taught me how to bake, how to cook, how to ride a bike, and how to drive. Whenever I needed his help, he was always right there. He was there to pick me up from school, to help me with my homework, to take me to practices and recitals and dentist appointments and so much more. He even gave me my first job at his office. Not because he needed it, but because I did. He dropped everything to help his family and friends, but even to people he barely even knew. His heart was so big and filled with so much love. He was always there for me and always believed in me. When I graduated from high school, he told me, go and be whoever you want to be and do whatever makes you happy in life. He said, it doesn't matter how far you go or where you end up, I'll take care of everything. He was always the rock of the family. He always wanted everyone to just be together, even to just cook and to eat and just be with each other. His smile lit up the room. It was so big and so beautiful, you couldn't help but smile back. He was such an amazing man. He was so funny, so caring, so loving, and even such a hard ass. The last conversation I had with my Uncle Raj was about 2 weeks ago. I know I'm really late on getting my license, but I had my test and needed someone to take me. So I called on my Uncle Raj. And he said, sweetie, I'd love to take you, but I might have a meeting, but don't worry, I'll figure something out. Even when he knew he couldn't always be there, he made sure someone was. It was my birthday, that day he went to the hospital, and I was wondering why he never called me. And I was gonna give him such a hard time because he forgot my birthday. He's gonna miss so much more than just birthdays. He won't be there to cheer me on for when I graduate college. He won't be there to dance at my wedding for when I get married. He won't be there to spoil my kids for when I have kids. I don't know why. I don't know why this had to happen to such an amazing man. I don't know why things are the way they are, but all we can do now is just try and be more like my Uncle Raj, the caring and loving and helpful man that he was. Uncle Raj, you will be forever missed. And I love you. I love you so much, and I will never forget everything that you've done for me. I will be there for Maddie and Luke and Auntie Lisa. With whatever they need, I'm going to do whatever I can to help them, just like how you were always there for me. I love you.
On behalf of me and my brother, I hope to tell you about the man my Uncle Raj was. My brother wanted to speak, but didn't think he could make it through. I never thought I would be saying this speech to everyone. This was not supposed to happen. My Uncle Raj was not supposed to leave us. We were supposed to have years left of laughter, celebration, and love. After he passed, I began getting texts from so many different people.
They all said the same thing to me. He loves you guys very much. And it was true. He loved me and my siblings with all his heart. He loved us like we were his own children. He wouldn't hesitate to spoil us, to buy us whatever we needed, and to yell at us and to lecture us. He was like another father to me. He gave us such a great childhood. From teaching us how to bake, he used to call me Cupcake. Dancing around my grandparents' house laughing. Take us to California to spend summers with him and making home videos together. He was there for me whenever I needed him. He would drop everything he was doing just to do a little favor for me. I counted on him for everything. So many times I would just tell my parents, "Don't worry, Uncle Raj got it for me. Or Uncle Raj is taking care of it." Now who am I gonna call to pick me up when I'm stuck, to fix my car, to help me back, to preach to me, or to think the world of me? Even if I did something wrong, he would tell me how proud he was of me. We've cried together, we've laughed together. He always told me we're so alike because we're both the middle children. He said he understood me and why I was the way I was. He said we are both leaders and that I hope that one day I can follow in his footsteps. He never judged me, yet held my hand through all the tough times. He was supposed to be here now holding my hand. He was supposed to fight harder. Why did he leave us all here? For what? He was what held our family together. He was our backbone and our strength. Everything we are as a family is because of him. Even if I had a little fight with my parents or grandparents, it would be him talking me through it. His heart was full of love, and he would light up a room with his presence. He was an outstanding man, always being a role model and had a heart of gold. Uncle Raj loved his Sabbaths. He used to have us for every Friday night for dinner at his house when we were younger. We would get together and begin cooking and have such a great time eating together. It didn't matter how tired he was from the whole week or if he was having a bad day. He would still come pick us up with a big smile on his face. He also loved his Sabbath potlucks. And we would have so much fun just fellowshipping and being goofy together. My heart is broken knowing that I didn't spend the last Thanksgiving with him because I was in Uganda. While I was there, he would text me all the time saying how proud he was of me. And he loves that I'm making a difference in the world. Yet he was the one who made a difference in all of our worlds. I thought we were all going to grow old together. He was supposed to see me get married, have children, and be there every step of the way. Uncle Raj, I hope you know that I'm going to spoil Maddie and Luke like how you did to me, Shaish and Chefu. They will never know what it's like to feel alone, and they will always be loved. I will be there to take them lunches at school, going to practices and teaching them how to be like you. Auntie Lisa has nothing to worry about. Uncle Raj, your little girl, your Cupcake loves you very much, and you will be in my heart forever.
I would like to thank and each one of you for attending my nephew's funeral service. My nephew, he's not nephew to me. Actually, he's a son to me. Every day, he calls home to find out how we are doing. We used to tell Nana, we are okay. Suppose if we want anything, we want this Nana, so and so. But I don't want to keep him busy. I'm very thankful to him every time. He wants to help me. On every birthday and Mother's Day, my son brings me gifts. I don't have any kids, all of my nieces and nephews. I have more Mother's Day gifts, very precious children. Everybody, Raju, Mary, and everybody are very loving to me. When my nephew was born in my parents' place, on seeing the newborn baby only, my father said, "Oh, అమ్మా రాజ్ అంటే ఏమనుకున్నావు అమ్మా ఎంత పెద్ద మనిషి దాట్ మీన్స్ వాట్ డిడ్ యూ థింక్ అబౌట్ రాజు అమ్మ హీఈస్ ఎ జెంటిల్ మ్యాన్ మై ఫాదర్ టోల్డ్ ప్రొఫెసీ ద సేమ్ వే మై నెఫ్యూ ఈజ్ ఎ జెంటిల్ మ్యాన్ సిన్స్ చైల్డ్హుడ్ హీ వాస్ నెవర్ నాటీ అండ్ మిస్చీవస్ ఐ సా హిమ్ వెన్ హీ వాస్ 19 years old, I immigrated to United States when he was 19 years old. From that time onwards, he takes so much burden. He wants to help his first cousin's parents, friends and relatives. He wants to help everybody. I love him so much. My nephew passed away, left this world very young age. He's very young. He's 46 years old. He's going to be 47 next month. 22nd, I would like to quote from the Holy Bible a small verse, Psalm number 116, 15th verse. Precious is in the sight of the Lord the death of the saints. My nephew is very precious. The word, English word precious means great. Prasastamainadi, the boy is very precious boy. I would like to tell, since he died very young, I would like to tell you some other thing. The great poet, Telugu poet, who wrote about the young people. His name is Sri Paravastu Chinnaya Suri. All the Telugu people, Andhra people who have studied high school know his name. Without this prose or prose, there won't be Telugu text, complete Telugu text. Evadu buddhimantudo. వాడు వృద్ధుడు కానీ ఏండ్లు మీరిన వాడు వృద్ధుడు గాడు బుద్ధిమంతుడు మీన్స్ వెరీ వెరీ పయస్ బుద్ధిమంతుడు మీన్స్ ఎస్ లాంగ్ లైఫ్ ఈజ్ వెరీ గ్రేట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎ బ్లెస్సింగ్ బట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ ద గ్రేట్నెస్ సమ్ టైమ్స్ హౌ మెనీ ఇయర్స్ యూ లివ్ ఈవెన్ ఇన్ యువర్ లైఫ్ హౌ యూ లివ్డ్ దట్ కమ్స్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ద గ్రేట్ బ్లెస్సింగ్ living long life. I appreciate my nephew. Nana, you are Vruddhudu. You died very young, but you are Vruddhudu, Nana. I don't want to criticize anything. I love all the old people. It is a blessing. My many more people lived. They have short life. They did very great things in their lives. Jane Austen lived 42 years. She wrote a beautiful novel, Pride and Prejudice, Emma. Oliver Goldsmith lived 47 years. He wrote a beautiful novel. I would like to thank my nephew for what he had done. My precious nephew had. Nana, you left very early. You are precious, Nana. I love you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you. Bangarkonda, that means Golden Hill. My nephew is Bangarkonda to me. He is precious.
I've been in a daze, and I'm still in denial. And I still can't accept that Raj is gone. And I'm trying to act like everything's normal. And I don't want to break down and cry, because I want to be strong for my parents. For Lisa, Matt, and Luke. And it's still not hitting me. I just jotted a few lines down this morning. I don't even know if it makes sense. But I'm gonna try. Dear Raj, are you really gone? Did you leave us? I can't believe it. It's a bad nightmare for me. Can't believe you won't be here to see your precious children grow up, to see my children get married, to grow old with your beautiful wife, to be there for my birthday, and my birthday is today. You're the kindest, sweetest person I knew, and always doing good for others. When our car would break down, we'd always call Raj. He'd always come and get us. He would say, I know you guys are so busy with work. He would order the part. He would even pick it up for us. when we had come back from camp, when we were gone, he would take care of our dog. And when we had come back from being gone away, he would buy groceries and have something there for us to eat. When I told him we were moving, he was excited for us. And he came and he went and he bought all this special wrap to wrap our furniture. And there's a certain kind of padded wrap that he needed to get, and he couldn't find it anywhere. And I think the GC had that. And he went there and bought that wrap for us, and he came and helped wrap our furniture. He was a really good son. When my mom got sick, he was the one who would feed her. He was the one who would help her with her chemo and inject that into her. He would always take her to her appointments. And when she received her radiation, he was the one who was there every morning taking her for that therapy, for that treatment for 8 weeks. I hardly did anything when my mom was sick. I had my little children, but it was Raj and Sammy who took such good care of her. He was a hero to my children, and he played an important part. He played an important role in their lives. Once I'd asked him for a ride when I was going home, and there we passed this man in his car. Was broken, and Raj rolled down the window, and he said, "Hey, buddy, do you need a ride? Can I help you with anything?" He was like that, always helping people. I remember even, like, there was also another time, and there was somebody, you know, just putting their hand out, like, for money, and he would just give it. He wouldn't think twice, and Raj knew that he didn't need it, but he would just give it to him. And he said, "Mary," he said, "my heart tells me to give it. I don't care if he needs it or not, but we don't know why." And he would just give it. Raj was a wonderful husband. He was always telling us about how nice Lisa was and all the things that she did for him. He was a great father, always doting on his sons. And he set an example for them. I have so much more to say, but I really can't go on. I'm still in this daze, and I feel like I'm still not with it. And it was only at 9 o'clock that I started writing this. I didn't even want to get ready and come. I'm sorry I made everybody late. I called Sammy. I said, "Sammy, please, Sammy, tell them to wait just another 15 minutes. And I just don't know about this nightmare, this story, this horrible thing that's happened. I know he's resting in peace, but I just think it's so unfair. But we can't question God, and he knows what's best. Thank you."
Selfless. That's the word that best describes my brother. He was selfless in his love for his family and friends. He was selfless in his love for me. I have 1,000 stories that I want to tell you. I'm so grateful for that. But I'd like to share with you a lot of memories, and one of them, my brother, you know how he loves to cook. My parents worked early, and Raj would get up and make me breakfast every day before school. And then we would walk to school together. It was our little routine, and I loved it. Raj loved to spend time with his friends and family, and he loved to just sit, eat, and laugh. And many of you shared that with him. There will be a void now, and it won't be filled. But that's appropriate because my brother was one of a kind. Raj had a great deal of respect for his elders and did many things out of principle. And you knew it because he would tell you. Yeah. I did many things that were stupid and he set me straight. Raj always let me tag along. Always. You can ask all the guys. I was always there. He never said no to me. I just wanted to be around my brother. And I see that in Matt and Luke. I always call Raj for advice. Always. And it was, he always put me on the right path. And it was okay. Who am I gonna call now? Everyone here would gladly trade place with Raj so that his bright light could continue to shine. I love you, Big Smooth. Thank you.
You all heard, what Raju did. You all know how my son is, how great name he got. I can't tell you anymore, but one incident I will tell you. Nana. Nana, I want to go to Costco. Can you take me? Okay, Mom. I'll be there. You get ready. I can take you this evening. I said, Nana, whenever you have time, but I don't want to trouble you. Whenever you are available, take me. Then I go. Mama, pick up whatever you want. I'll take you. Then I pick up whatever I want. I go to tomatoes. Then everybody is picking up the big ones and putting in there. Then I saw that, oh, let me take. Mom, whatever it is on your tray, that's it. Don't touch anything. Then I say, okay, now, whatever you say, I will. Then I pick up. My son is an honest man, God-fearing, loving and kind. I don't know where it is. No, but Lord gave me. And he took me. He gave me a good gift. He kept it. And he took him away. He blessed his holy name. That's it. Thank you, man.
Hi, everyone. So what I'm going to be playing is a song. It's an original song that I wrote. And the story behind it is I just started playing something. And my mom heard it, and she said, Luke, you should put some words to it. So she said, talk to Dad about that. So I went up to Dad, and I said, hey, Dad, can you come up with some words for this? And he said, yeah. And then he said, I'll make it like an Elvis song. So I said, okay, try. And we started trying to do some stuff, but it just didn't work. So I said, I'll just leave it without words, and maybe a little later I'll get your help some more. And then I started, I did another little thing to it, and I added a drum beat and a solo to it. My dad said, now it sounds like an Elvis song. And I told him, I don't know. So I'm going to dedicate this song to my dad.
Thank you, Luke. What a beautiful tribute and song. The family has asked me to share just a few thoughts about how Raj blessed our church here at Beltsville and our school community. And this is going to be tough for me because I consider Raj a true friend. And I would guess that most of you here today feel the same way. You just had that way about him. He made friends so easily. He exuded charm and a personal interest in everyone, regardless of age, background, or status. He had the way of just creating a welcoming, accepting atmosphere. First time I met Raj, I instantly liked him. Just won me over, just like that. And he told me later that he made it his personal mission to make sure that no one walked into our church without being warmly greeted and welcomed. And he was always on the lookout for new people that he didn't recognize to welcome them and make them feel comfortable. As was mentioned earlier, he blessed our church with his cooking ability, and he'd make some excellent chili that I enjoyed at some of our social events. He also had a great sense of humor, and this came out for us as a church when he would tell his famous children's stories on Sabbath morning about his escapades in the legendary Tacoma Park. We knew for sure that the setting of his stories would be Tacoma Park. We didn't know what else would happen. Also, he was famous for his Elvis impersonation, and that was something that we enjoyed seeing as well. He was a strong supporter of the school. He exerted positive leadership as our school board chairman for a number of years. He was always volunteering and helping out at any activity the school was holding. And I remember one day, as he'd been volunteering all day at the school picnic, talking with him at lunchtime, and the conversation quickly turned to one of his passions, which was politics. And he began to share with me all kinds of stuff about his political views. And I was just amazed at how well informed he was. And I remember thinking, I don't have to read a newspaper or anything. I just got to talk to Raj, and I will know exactly what's going on. But what was fascinating for me is that the passion for him behind his politics was to help the disadvantaged and to care for those whose needs were not met in our country. He believed very passionately that no one in our country should be going hungry and that we should do everything we can to help those who are in need. Raj also has had the reputation of helping create the atmosphere in our church that was very welcoming of children and family. And as has been mentioned already in many, many different ways, he was heavily involved in ministering to children. And one of the ways that he did that, he would teach our Sabbath school classes, he would lead songs for the children, and just the kids would just flock to him like a magnet. He just drew them towards him. But I got to see it firsthand this summer as he was one of the coaches of the Sable baseball team. And he was coach of the team my son was on. And so I got to see him every night that I was at the game and how he reached out and mentored and guided the lives of these young people. So we have the team here today, and I might like to ask them to stand. And I'm going to ask Dallas to come forward, and he has a message that he'd like to read on behalf of the team. Thank you, Dallas. Yes, you can just use that. It's on. It should be on. Yeah.
Coach Raj was our baseball coach this summer and was a great coach, but even more, he was a great example of a Christian athlete. When we would be playing games, Coach Raj was always the coach reminding us that the score didn't matter, but the way we played the game did. When we were beating teams or even losing, he would hold us at third base if errors were made by the other team. He knew it was more important to show sportsmanship than to win a game. That's something we will carry with us always. Coach Raj cared for each of us players. We could always count on him to cheer us on and take time to help us when we were having trouble. Miss Adanala, Luke, and Matthew, Coach Raj taught us what it meant to be a team and to be there for each other. Look around. We are all your team, and just like Coach Raj taught us, we are now here for you.
Thank you, Dallas. Thank you so much. You can be seated. Thank you. As you can see, he had an effect wherever he went on young people. He was also proud of his family, and a friend told me a story that they were at a wedding and Raj came up to them and he was just out of earshot of Lisa, and he leaned over and he whispered, "I've got the prettiest bride at this wedding, and I always will." And that's how he felt, you could tell, in all his interactions. He thought very highly of you, Lisa, and his boys. Luke, whenever you play the guitar, your dad was full of pride and joy to see you using your giftedness and serving in the church. And Maddie, when you would read a scripture, he would shine with pride as well, or when you prayed for the church. He also had a desire to share God's love. He told me a number of times he had many friends that were out of the church, and he didn't want to preach to them or put them on a guilt trip. He just wanted them to have the same assurance of God's love and salvation that he had. He wanted them to spend eternity with him and to be there with him in heaven. In this way, his life was a continual preaching of the gospel through actions that spoke much louder than words. And because Raj was such an amazing person, we feel the pain of his loss very deeply. Our hearts are heavy with grief as we have been forced to say an early goodbye to someone that we all loved. We feel shock, grief, pain, denial, maybe even anger as we try to accept what none of us want to accept. This wasn't supposed to happen this way. And we wonder why. Why did God let this happen to such an amazing person? Why did God let this happen to such a great family? And I am not here today to answer that question because I don't know why. But I would like to address a question that I may be able to answer. That question is where? Where is God in all of this? And what kind of God would allow all of the suffering that we see in this world? And when we suffer, does it mean that God has abandoned us? I know in my personal journey, I've had moments where certain hopes and dreams were shattered by one devastating event. And as my world crumbled around me, I found a grace and a strength that were not my own that bore me through. And I believe, looking back, that that was Jesus carrying me when I couldn't even walk. And although I cannot fully comprehend what you all are feeling right now, I believe that Jesus wants to carry each of you through this painful time. In John chapter 5, we find the story of a man who had dealt with tremendous pain in his life. He'd been crippled for 38 years. And I'm sure he wondered why. Why did you allow this, God? And we pick up the story in John chapter 5, verse 6. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned he had been in this condition a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the man replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred, and when I'm trying to get in, someone else goes in ahead of me." What we see here is that Jesus notices the suffering of this man. And it doesn't matter how the suffering comes into our lives or what forms it takes, Jesus notices our pain. And like Raj, Jesus has a special place in his heart for those who are suffering. In fact, I believe we enter into a special place in his care when we suffer. He grants a special grace to those who are in pain, and he offers his gracious healing to all who wish to receive it, just as he does for this man. In verse 8, it says, "Then Jesus said to him, 'Get up, pick up your mat, and walk.' And at once the man was cured, and he picked up his mat, and he walked." I don't want you to miss this one point that comes through this passage for me. That after all this struggling this man had gone through, trying to reach the water that he believed would give him healing, after all these years of struggling and struggling and struggling to reach out and receive the healing that he believed the water would give him, the water came to him. It came directly to him. Jesus, the living water, stood before him and gave him the healing that he had desperately sought. And I believe that he stands before us today as well, and that he is willing to grant us healing of our hearts as we grieve this pain and loss. Tears are appropriate when we feel pain and loss. It is right for us to grieve today. We are all going to miss Raj so much, and we feel the pain of that loss. But thankfully, we grieve with hope. In Jesus, we have hope. We find love. We find healing. We find hope that one day Jesus will set everything right, and hope that we will see Raj again in the earth made new. So we don't know why today, but we do know where. Where is God in all of this? He's in the hearts of the people who have been there for you, Lisa, and Matthew, and Luke, and Sammy, and Mary, and all of the family. The massive crowd that showed up last night to share their love and concern, the packed church that we have today, those who are in the overflow room, the 150 or more people watching online right now. Jesus is there in the hearts of all of these people, wanting to bring love and comfort and encouragement. And I believe that he is also there in your own heart, speaking to you today, holding you in his arms, saying, "It is going to be okay, because I am with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. I will carry you when you can't walk any longer. I will heal you. It may happen slowly, one day at a time, but the healing will come. I will heal your heart, and when you feel like all your efforts to reach me aren't working, just remember that I'm there anyways. Sometimes you'll sense my presence, sometimes you won't, but I am always there. And those who are suffering have a special place in my heart."
Our family would like to thank Ruby Memorial Hospital for the care and love they gave Raj. We also would like to thank the funeral home for assisting us during this difficult time. A very special thanks to the Beltsville Seventh-day Adventist Church for hosting the receiving line and the service today, for loving Raj and his family all these years. I would like to thank the Southern Asia Church for hosting the repast. There has been so many people who have been a strong strength to our family during this difficult time. Please know that we love and appreciate each one of you. Thank you. Thank you for your love and support. Thank you for your visits and prayer. Thank you for the food and concern that you showed us. Raj was a very special man who had many friends, some of whom have traveled here to be here. If you do not see your name listed as a pallbearer, but would like to take part, we welcome you to walk behind the casket. Once again, thank you for being here. We love you all.
Please stand and join us in singing now our final song, Safe in the Arms of Jesus. The words will be on the screen.
God, our Father. In moments like this, we have but one place to turn to. For your word has reminded us this morning, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes forth in the morning. Today, there is one more reason for us to wait for that day when the Lord himself will descend with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Until that day, hold thy daughter Lisa, tender children Luke, Matthew, parents Uncle Christopher and Auntie, Sister Mary, Brother Sammy, family, friends, and all of us safe in thine arms. Even so, Lord Jesus, come, is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. The family is truly grateful for your presence here this morning. Due to time factor, as soon as the family arrives at the graveside, we will have the committal service. Repast will follow at the Southern Asian Church. So those of us who want to join, please do make your way as soon as possible to the George Washington Cemetery. And please join us for the repast at the Southern Asian Church on East Randolph Road. Thank you once again. God bless us all.
Friends and family, as we prepare to go on to George Washington Cemetery, I ask to allow us to bring the casket out with the pallbearers. Give us ample time to move the funeral coach from this side of the building over to the exit of the church so that we can begin the procession. I ask that everyone is joining us in the procession to grab one of the yellow funeral signs that you'll see as soon as you exit the chapel. Place that on your rearview mirror. Your headlights on, bright lights, and your four-way flashers. I also ask those, being that we were going to start the interment service as soon as the family arrives, if some of you, those that want to go on to the repast at the Southern Asian Seventh-day Adventist Church, you're welcome to go on there, and the family will meet you as soon as they're done at the cemetery. Thank you. God bless you all. Thank you.